Katrina was the first, a disaster we never could have imagined. 80% of a major American city flooded, a storm surge that leveled parts of the Mississippi coast. Images of people crying for help from rooftops are forever seared in our minds. That's why we must do everything possible to prevent the devastation from another Katrina. We look back 15 years and hope we never look another hurricane like Katrina in the eye again. The city of New Orleans pushed to the brink on this day back in 2005, and unfortunately, 15 years later, time has not healed the open wound created by Hurricane Katrina.
This is our hometown, the place that we were born and raised. We're strong and we're resilient. So you know what happened after the storm knocked us down? We got back up and moved forward together in light of this tragedy. A region underwater. Tens of thousands of homes flooded. Fires, looting, utter despair. Katrina brought chaos that many had never seen before. 15 years later, the images are still, at times, hard to watch.
All right, Margaret, what can you tell us?
It's a Category 5. Katrina is now a Category 5 hurricane. Katrina made landfall 6:10 Monday morning at Burris with 125 mile per hour winds. Storm surge 15 to 19 feet from Plaquemines to New Orleans East. The highest storm surge along the Mississippi coast, 24 to 28 feet, 20 miles wide, and it moved inland 6 miles.
Initially, many thought the city of New Orleans dodged a bullet. Yes, there was damage. Hotel windows blown out, cars destroyed, and the Superdome roof heavily damaged. But then the levees broke.
Water pouring through the missing wall.
Families who chose to stay stuck in their homes. Many needed to be rescued by boat from their attics and rooftops. The damage total in the hundreds of billions. The city, state, and federal response inadequate. Emergency evacuation orders given too late for thousands to get out, so they were stuck. The convention center, filled with panic, fear, and despair. A scene that you should never see again in any major American city. While so many first responders saved countless lives, others didn't, and police misconduct reared its ugly head. The city evacuated for over a month, many wondering if they could ever come back. But we're woven from a different fabric here. No one was going to give in. And 15 years later, we're still going together.
While most of us have been able to recover, residents in one neighborhood are still fighting to come back.
Margaret, when the Industrial Canal levee wall broke, it devastated the lower Ninth Ward. WDSU's Aubrey Killian shows us what people living in that part of the city are still dealing with.
Into a rail yard here at the levee wall.
For the lower nine, Katrina was powerful and catastrophic. Thousands of families once lived here. Many never returned.
It hurts. It hurts. 15 years, 20 years ago, there were kids here. You would hear music. You would smell the best of foods. Everyone spoke to everyone.
Timothy Washington was born and raised in the Lower Nine.
Everybody cries, this is the melting pot right here, New Orleans. Could have fooled me. Just look around. Look around.
And for Richard Bell, he lost everything and also came back. He's devoted his life to bringing back his neighborhood.
You could replace material, but you can't replace life.
We in a war zone here in L9. This is a war zone.
Many of his neighbors were not able to rebuild. Schools have struggled to return. There's no major grocery stores or pharmacies out here.
It's gone on almost 20 years, and we know better than what we was after Katrina.
And they say the painful memories of Katrina may fade just a little as time goes on, but they are still nearly impossible to forget when there's always a physical reminder of what happened.
We don't have a community anymore.
And while so many people are frustrated with what's happened here in the Lower Nine over the past 15 years, Bell and Washington stressed that they are never going to give up on their neighborhood. This is their home and always will be.
15 years forward, two success stories for the city of New Orleans, Lakeview and Gentilly. My brother, WDSU's Fletcher Mackle, covered both of those neighborhoods back in 2005, and today he went back and revisited both.
This is the exact spot along the London Avenue Canal where the levee breached 15 years ago this evening, changing so many people's lives forever, including Travers and myself, because the house that we grew up in, that our mother lived in for 35 years, is less than two blocks away.
Oh, Lord.
Back in 2005, once the floodwater was pumped out, I took my mom home and we saw firsthand a lifetime of memories washed away. And when we left, she told me this.
You know, it's another chapter in my life.
An ending for Judy Mackle, but a beginning for Samuel Wickline.
I think it's kind of transformed over the last 5 to 10 years. It's become much younger, a lot more children around.
Wickline is raising his family less than 50 yards from the levee breach, his home, one of dozens newly constructed in the area, because
it's a new chapter in the book, kind of a fresh start.
The neighborhood next to Gentilly is, of course, Lakeview. And because of the breach here on the 17th Street Canal, where we are right now, this neighborhood was 80% flooded, and the waters reached as high as 8 to 10 feet.
Area. This is the first ground level video that many people have ever seen of the damage that Hurricane Katrina's floodwaters caused.
Like parts of Gentilly, 15 years forward, the West Lakeview neighborhood is booming with new construction. So Rusty Kipker and his wife are happy they played the long game.
People chose to move away and different things like that. But you know, when it's home, so you can stick around and make it better and or go to somewhere else. But for us, it's always kind of been, you know, you want to be a part of the change and everything kind of coming back.
And it's not just the neighborhoods in Lakeview and Gentilly that are doing better. Here along Harrison Avenue and over on Elysian Fields, there are now almost double the number of businesses that there were 15 years ago.
As Hurricane Katrina roared towards the Louisiana coast and St. Bernard Parish, no one realized their lives were about to change forever.
But 15 years later, Heath Allen shows us how tragedy has now turned to triumph.
Father, we building this son of a back, and we're going to be better than what we were.
The late, colorful St. Bernard Parish President Junior Rodriguez defiantly shaking his fist at Hurricane Katrina 15 years ago. The storm, the flood, had just devastated his entire parish. But along with the wind and water, Katrina brought a fierce determination to rise from the mud and debris, building a bigger, faster, stronger St. Bernard.
You know, most people would have given up. My dad said, we gotta come back.
Campos Marina has been a mainstay at Shell Beach, wiped out more than once, but Katrina couldn't beat them, not the oil spill, and COVID won't either.
When I think back, I just think that, you know, we have it in us to be together, to help each other. Because if you look at that time, that's what I think about more than anything.
Parish President Guy McGinnis rode the storm and its immediate aftermath out right here at Chalmette High School, where victims of the storm were brought right as the winds died down. 15 years later, even in the midst of this coronavirus pandemic, St. Bernard is thriving.
We're looking to move to Araby to raise their family. We still have a great education system. Katrina didn't stop that.
The opportunity's here. If you really want it, it's here.
From his corner on Judge Perez Highway, Jeff Pullman has watched St. Bernard's rebirth. In the days following the storm, it was he and his family that fed storm victims. Now, he sees families moving in.
You know, we got some new folks coming in here, as well as some people coming back into the area that was actually from here pre-Katrina.
If you look at our quality of life here, you know, the progress that we've made over the last 15 years, and particularly over the last five, is unbelievable.
Needless to say, flood protection is light years ahead of where it was 15 years ago. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers dropping tons of concrete, miles of levee. But inside the flood protection or out, The heart of St. Bernard is strong.
Still to come, they took center stage during the recovery, but many fell from grace. Where are the leaders of Katrina 15 years later? In the WDSU lobby, a tribute honoring the employees who worked at WDSU when Hurricane Katrina made landfall on August 29, 2005. In the face of their own personal challenges, they were there when viewers needed them most. Some of them still employed at WDSU 15 years later.
When I came back, I mean, there was intermittent power. Oh, it smelled so bad. There was debris, 5 stories high, all on West End for blocks and blocks and blocks. I didn't know what the future was. And I thought, could I live anywhere else? And I decided I couldn't. New Orleans has always been my home. I couldn't go anywhere else. I was going to help rebuild.
So I remember the only time I was really nervous, the water was coming up outside, the storm was coming in. Literally, the water was probably up on my legs. Cars were already underwater. Cars had already been floating away. Fire trucks were floating away. And I realized I needed to get back inside the Chalmette governmental building. And when I went and tried the front doors, they wouldn't open. So I was really trying hard, and the water was coming up. And people on the inside did the same thing. They were trying from the inside to open up. And we're looking at each other through the glass, and we can't get the doors open. And all of a sudden, everything, the pressure of the water, everything just caved in. And the water just picked me up off the ground and floated me right into the middle of the Chalmette governmental building. It was kind of like God said, let me get that door for you.
In Jefferson Parish, billions of dollars have been spent on rebuilding efforts since the storm made landfall. But in those critical days after the storm, locals played a key role.
And in a parish that touches the Gulf, the river, and the lake, Katrina played a major role in how Jefferson Parish now lives with water. Here's Jennifer Crockett.
The worst disaster in Jefferson Parish was Hurricane Katrina, by far.
Well, I had a lot of young personnel. They were all scared, trying to be a father figure to them, trying to make sure they're okay. We're deep inside. I didn't know if we were going to be okay.
3 days after the incident, there was no FEMA people here yet. So, you know, we were all looking for the cavalry to come. The cavalry didn't come. The cavalry was us.
And that's the lesson West Bank Fire Chiefs Gary Gerard and Don Robertson said Katrina burned into their departments to trust each other and prepare to be the only lifelines left.
I'm sitting here saying 15 years later that we got through it. We are better prepared for anything now.
And 15 years later, Jefferson Parish is also better protected. The Army Corps of Engineers building a $14.6 billion hurricane and storm risk reduction system. It includes the 2 largest pump stations in the world.
I want people to identify our area as being the masters of being able to live with water. And it should be the product that we sell to the rest of the country.
Katrina in 2005 was a defining disaster, but 2020 has not been kind either.
People over profit.
COVID-19 bringing new fears, new challenges, and that same old grit to get through it together.
For more than 100 years, Plaquemines Parish has been known for producing riverboat pilots and, wait, the best oysters in the world. Well, 15 years ago, it became known for something else, the place where Hurricane Katrina made landfall. Here's Heath Allen.
Every once in a while, I run into somebody who has relocated, and their heart is still here.
The northern part of Plaquemines Parish has come back, but the southern end is a different story. People, business, and economy sadly lacking in southern Plaquemines, missed opportunity.
They could have been here. Jobs could have been here if our government and our state and our federal government had gotten together and dredged those passes so that we can get those ships in here to create more jobs.
The oil field was our biggest
employer, and now it's diminished to hardly anything.
Parish President Kirk Lapine agrees there's a wealth of resources in Lower Plaquemine, certainly now a magnet for the sport fishing industry.
A bright spot on the horizon. We've got a lot of people coming down, but I don't, again, see where the parish is actually welcoming these people with open arms as we should.
We still need to invest in this area. Don't write us off because of the dread of the possibility of another major hurricane.
That is certainly the prayer.
From pinpoint focus to complete ineptitude, those that found themselves in leadership positions 15 years ago when Katrina hit either rose to the occasion or wilted under the pressure. With a city on the brink, New Orleans Mayor Ray Nagin ordered an evacuation as Katrina neared the coastline. The Democrat won re-election 6 months later, and many feel it was all downhill from there.
Any comment on the 10 years of Nagin?
Nagin was convicted on bribery-related charges in 2014, and until recently was serving a 10-year jail sentence. He was released from prison due to the COVID-19 pandemic.
I'm not supposed to be talking about this case.
Jefferson Parish President Aaron Broussard made national headlines in the storm's aftermath. He was also convicted on kickback-related charges and served jail time. Then Congressman Bill Jefferson represented the bulk of the city's damaged areas. He was also later voted out of office, convicted on bribery charges, and served jail time. The state's first and only female governor led Louisiana when Katrina made landfall. Kathleen Blanco passed away in the summer of 2019. She was credited with starting the Road Home Relief Program to get people money for their flooded properties. We also lost Henry Jr. Rodriguez. The St. Bernard Parish president helped lead that area following Katrina. He passed away in 2018. Also gone, then Jefferson Parish Sheriff Harry Lee, who died in 2007. 15 years later, his daughter, Cynthia, is now the top elected official in that parish. Bobby Jindal was a freshman congressman representing Jefferson and Orleans Parish when Katrina hit. He later became a two-term governor. Lieutenant Governor Mitch Landrieu went on to become mayor of his hometown, serving two terms. Lieutenant General Russell Honoré coined the phrase stuck on stupid as he led the military response and recovery. He retired from the Army in 2008. Many of these people revered for their dedication to the recovery. Others still frowned upon 15 years later for their perceived lack of leadership.
Back in 2005, it was all about the levees. Still to come, the challenges we face in the future.
We were hoping police were going to rescue as many people as they possibly could, and we're trying to help them going, hey, there's somebody yelling for help over there, or there's somebody over here. Or when somebody swims up to the boat, you stick your hand out and help them. I mean, at a certain point, people are trying to get out and they're trying to save their lives and that of their loved ones. So if anything is, you know, stuck in my mind, it's that. It's the fact that you saw people being rescued in the most dire circumstances, the most dire situation, and you really see the spirit of helping, if you will.
The first time we ever saw aerials all the way from Shell Beach to Venice, the most devastating thing I remember seeing from the air was the Beerus water tower on the ground.
Lived here in the station for about a month and a half, and we had to protect one another. And I remember making it my duty before some of the guys would leave the building. I had one experience with Heath Allen to where I'm like, hey, look me in the eyes, squeeze my hand, and let me know you're okay before you go out and take in some of these images.
Founded in the 1960s, New Orleans East is the city's youngest neighborhood.
Bounded by the Industrial Canal, the Intercoastal Waterway, and Lake Pontchartrain, it's also one of the city's lowest-lying areas. Let's go back to Fletcher with more from New Orleans East. Travers and Margaret, we're here in Joe Brown Park. 15 years ago, this area was inundated with water. Now, professionally, covering Katrina was a responsibility for so many journalists, but for many of us at WDSU, it was also personal. Retired legendary news anchor Norman Robinson lived in New Orleans East.
It was a wonderful place, you know. It was the place for families, and we used to go walking in the evenings, and I was raising my granddaughter at that time. She had a little electric Jeep. You know, she used to drive it around the community. We'd drive around the block.
But Katrina destroyed Norman's home, and for so many, life in the East changed forever. The population dropped by more than 10,000. Numerous national chain stores opted not to reopen. Violent crime spiked. The struggle in the East has been difficult, but Councilwoman and longtime resident Cindy Nguyen believes recent business development, coupled with affordable home ownership, is helping her area turn a corner.
And I think as we move and look forward to the next 15 years, you're gonna see District E, the East, is gonna come back really strong and much better.
And Robinson, who moved away after the storm, hopes she's right.
And I'm always looking over at Spring Lake, my old neighborhood, you know, just hoping that the whole area will somehow be revitalized and that maybe somehow, some way, I can come back.
And back to Joe Brown Park here in New Orleans East. This area has been completely rebuilt. A state-of-the-art gym, football field, and baseball stadium. And Cindy Nguyen says that over the next 15 years, she expects more development like this. This major pump station at the 17th Street Canal didn't exist when Hurricane Katrina hit. It was built after the storm. And since 2005, no major hurricane or tropical storm has flooded the city. But in New Orleans, there's a new threat. 2 months ago in Gentilly, this man had to be rescued by firefighters due to high water and flooding brought on by a morning rainstorm. Yes, a rainstorm. And in recent years, really starting back in 2017, simple rain events in New Orleans have occasionally led to widespread flooding. Streets impassable, cars flooded, businesses shut down. The reason for this? Aging infrastructure. Pipes and drains that are over 100 years old, starting to crumble, leading to flooding across New Orleans during rain events. The mayor's office trying to get more money to repair the decades-old system. Some pumps predate World War II. But as for levee protection, some feel it's never been better. The three levees that failed 15 years ago on the 17th Street, London Avenue, and industrial canals have been fortified. Pump stations costing over $700 million have been built to drain stormwater out of the city. And hundreds of millions of dollars in federal money has been used to build massive levee walls in areas like St. Bernard, Plaquemines, and Jefferson Parishes, all designed to keep stormwater out, and it's worked, while underground pumps and drains are now the city's biggest threat for flooding. So as we deal with new challenges for our city, state, and region, we can always look back and reflect on the strength that we showed 15 years ago during Hurricane Katrina.
And don't forget, bad weather happens everywhere. At least with a hurricane, you can see it coming. We're gonna do our best to keep you prepared and safe. Thank you for watching.
I sat in that newsroom until the decision was made to leave. We were in the process of shutting off everything. 5 minutes before I had to get up and walk out, my brother, who also works at the station and was working here at the time, called me and said he had somehow made contact with my folks and everyone was okay.
Reflecting on Katrina 15 years later, the thing that still sticks out to me is that as a born and raised New Orleanian, that was the first time that I saw so many people from so many different diverse walks of life, black, white, old, young, rich, poor, from all the different neighborhoods, but we stood face to face and we looked at each other as New Orleanians and we realized we're all in this together. And I really think, reflecting on it, that that is one of the things that helped us and continues to help us moving forward.